Suppose you have a piece of cardboard of width 50 cm and height 30 cm and you wish to make a box from this piece of cardboard, like this with no top. We have to find what should be the height of this box that will give us maximum volume, so you can fit the most amount of objects in it. To make a box, you will cut out the corners and fold up the sides to make a box. Therefore, the measure of this cut will be the height and width of our cube. You can make many possible measures of cut, but we want a unique cut that will give us maximum volume of the box. The definition of optimization says it is the selection of a best element with regard to some criterion from some set of available alternatives. In our case, all the possible pairs of cuts are the available alternatives, and we have to find the best volume based on the criterion that it should be maximum. Thus, in one sentence, to choose the best height of the box that will give us maximum volume, and by using some kind of optimization technique, we can find this. If you are interested to know more about real world application of optimization, you can watch this video by ZStar. Suppose you have a function that takes one variable as an input and outputs a single number, and by optimization you can find the maximum or minimum of this function. If I show you this function in graph form, we have to find a value of x for which the y is minimum or maximum. For now, let us find the minimum of this function. By just seeing the graph, we can tell that for the value 0 of x, the graph is at minimum. But not every time you can just see at the graph and tell it's minimum, because not all the function can be expressed in graph form, or the data might be in foldy or even greater. To find the minimum of this function, we will initialize a point randomly anywhere in the graph. I have chosen 1.5, 3.25 as my initial guess. And after choosing this, we will find in which direction the function is decreasing most rapidly. And we can do this by calculating the gradient of this function. Finding gradient is quite simple. We just have to partially differentiate this function with respect to x. And the answer we will get after doing this is known as gradient. And by using this gradient, we can find the new value of x, which will minimize this function. We can find the new value of x by subtracting the x with the learning rate into gradient. And this new value of x is the minimized version of the previous x. We will discuss about learning rate in a moment. Now, let us put the real values of our x in this equation and calculate the x new. The value of the gradient is 3. We can substitute this in the next equation. For now, let the value of learning rate be 0.1. If we calculate this, we will get 1.2, which is the x new. And if I plot this, we have got the new point, which is the minimized version of the previous point. But our minimum is here, and the current point is at 1.2, 2.44, which is still too far away from the actual minimum. So now we will calculate the minimized version of our second point, which will give us a third point that is even minimized. And if we do this again and again, we will get closer and closer to our actual minimum. After doing this 10 times, we have got a point at 0.16, which is very close to our actual minimum. Doing this a few more times, you can get even more closer. One thing which is worth our attention is that as close the point is getting to the actual minimum, the distance between them is reducing, which ensures that the point doesn't overshoot from the minimum. What if I say that you can actually control how many big steps the point should take? You can do that by controlling this learning rate parameter. Currently, the learning rate is 0.1, but if we change it to 0.2, the steps have become bigger. And if we make it even bigger, the steps are now even greater. At a learning rate of 0.5, it only took 2 steps to reach the actual minimum. But increasing the learning rate even greater has made the point to overshoot from the minimum, and it is no longer able to reach the minimum. But what will happen if we reduce the learning rate from 0.1? Of course, the step size will reduce. Because of this, you will need more iteration to reach the minimum. The thing you just saw is known as the gradient descent algorithm, which is most widely used in machine learning algorithms. Gradient, which we calculated, is the slope or inclination towards the downward direction, which is known as descent. That's why the name gradient descent. If we were calculating the maximum of a function, this will be known as gradient ascent, meaning finding inclination towards an upward direction. The question may arise in your mind that how we can apply this concept in deep learning. In a deep neural network, weights and biases are the only two learnable parameters, meaning we have to optimize these two variables so as to reduce the error made by our model. Imagine this data, and if we want to approximate this, there can be many possible ways to set the weights and biases, but we want a particular value of weights and biases that will give us the least error rate. As this is a regression problem, let us use mean squared error as our loss function. You can see ypred here, but we can also write ypred like this because we have discussed this previously. It is the formula of our weighted sum. The example we saw previously only had one variable, but now there are two learnable parameters. First is weights and second is bias. That's why we will calculate two gradients, first with respect to weights and second with respect to bias. And then we can find new value of weights and bias and run this iteratively to find a particular value of weights and biases that can reduce the error rate. Here, our error rate can be calculated by the mean squared error loss function. For the first iteration, we will select the weights and biases randomly. As of now, let us keep them 0. That's why this is our initial line. As soon as we will start the gradient descent, the weights and biases will start updating. MSE error rate will start dropping and our line starts to move towards the points and tries to fit on it. After 10 iterations, the line has almost properly fitted on the data. The thing you just saw was the live animation of gradient descent training on this data. So I hope you have gained an intuition about how gradient descent works. If there might be any data instead of this, gradient descent works exactly the same way. The general way to calculate gradient descent is as follows. First, we will take any loss function f and then partially differentiate it with weights and biases, which are also known as gradients. Then we can use these gradients to update weights and biases so as to reduce the loss function f. There are three types of gradient descent in existence. The first is stochastic gradient descent. Here, on every epoch, weights and biases are updated by taking a single row, and this process is repeated till the end row is reached and one epoch is completed. In mini-batch gradient descent, instead of one row, a set of rows is chosen and updates are made. In our case, we have chosen two sets of rows, that means the number of batches is equal to 2. Usually, in real-world cases, while data has thousands of rows, the batch size is kept between 30 to 120. In the batch gradient descent, we simply train on the entire dataset at once and we repeat this for n number of epochs. Now, I am going to introduce a very important concept, which is momentum. Let us take the update rule from our previous example. The only thing that will change here is we will add momentum into change old in the gradient. The best way to understand this is by visualizing it. When we used gradient descent on this curve or data, it was able to find the minimum without any sweat, but not every function is as sincere as this. If we have data like this, it's not easy to find the minimum. Let's run normal gradient descent on this data, and it has completely screwed up. Now, if we introduce the concept of momentum in the equation of gradient descent, it can do better. Usually, the value of momentum is kept at 0.9. Just by adding this, the gradient descent was able to pass this local minimum, and now it is comparatively closer to the global minimum. After doing many trial and error, I found the correct value of learning rate with momentum equals 0.9 that was able to search the global minimum. It was 0.0782, and we have found the global minimum with the help of momentum. The reason momentum was able to find this is because the momentum is like a ball rolling down a hill. With normal gradient descent, this was so light that it got stuck in one of the valleys. But momentum makes this ball heavier by considering previous gradients. Due to this, it was able to search the global minimum. Today we learned many things about gradient descent and how it uses loss function to update weights and biases to reduce the error made by our loss function. Currently, gradient descent is used full-time in machine learning algorithms, but in deep learning, we use modern version of gradient descent like ADAM. The reason ADAM was not covered in this video is because this video was aimed to generate a general intuition of optimization in your brain. Soon in the future, I will make a special video for ADAM optimization, as it is comparatively math-heavy and tricky to understand. In the next video, we will summarize everything that we have learned and will define deep neural networks. Until then, see my other videos, and if you are from the very future, I may have already uploaded many videos in this series. So you can get this playlist link in the description and many other useful resources. See you in the next video.